Hello and welcome to NPTEL MOOC on Applied Electromagnetics for Engineers. So far we have spoken of, you know, as we complete the first part of our course, roughly one third into the total course duration, we have talked about transmission lines. We have understood how to, you know, calculate the voltage at different points on the transmission line. We know what happens when a transmission line is excited by a voltage pulse or a step voltage. We know how to match a transmission line to the given load or match the transmission line to the generator. We know how sinusoidal waves propagate on the transmission line, leading to the effects of phase, standing wave when there is a mismatch. We have calculated input impedance as seen from the source, derived the impedance transformation formula. We have talked about reflection coefficient. We have talked about standing wave ratio. We have talked about a lot of things. However, if I remember correctly, we have not really talked or introduced words such as electricity, magnetism, charge density, current density, modes. We have not talked about these words, right? Or we have not talked about Coulomb's law, Gauss's law, Faraday's law, Maxwell's equations, boundary conditions. These are the terms that you would normally associate with an electromagnetic course. When you talk of an electromagnetic course, these are the words that come naturally to your mind, and it would be very strange that we have gone roughly one third into the course and we have never mentioned these words before. Now, there was a very good reason why we did so, because the goal of this course is to teach you topics that are very relevant, which can be immediately applied, that is completely practical, and something that you would all appreciate, whether your, you know, higher interest is in understanding the electromagnetic fields or whatever, right? So most of you are familiar with computers, microcontrollers, FPGAs, digital hardware. Some of you might be, you know, going into specializing in analog circuit design at very high frequencies. So keeping this in mind, and the fact that these effects are much more easier to observe, are more very relevant, not that others are not relevant, but I'm talking about a common platform for all the engineers. So we decided that transmission line theory be the introduction to this course. However, transmission line theory is not electromagnetics. It assumes that someone has calculated by some means the primary constants of a transmission line, such as R, L, C, and G. Once the constants are given to you, then it is your job to find the secondary constants. It is your job to find how the voltages are changing, how the current is changing, and then to analyze all kind of behavior of a transmission line. So at the transmission line theory, when you are applying, you don't actually get to know how the quantities such as L and C, R and G are defined. In fact, you don't even get to know what is the definition of this, except telling you that L is a circuit element which we call as an inductor, which maintains a certain relationship between a voltage across its terminals and a current through its terminals. Of course, that's essentially what the transmission line theory is masking. It is completely masking the physical picture of the inductor or a transmission line, and it is kind of presenting to you an abstract picture in which the quantities R, L, C, G are the only interested quantities. For example, if I go back to this coaxial line, let me go to a coaxial line and draw the coaxial line for you. Right, so this is how the coaxial line would look. There is an inner conductor of some radius and there is an outer conductor of larger radius. Okay, so there is an inner conductor and an outer conductor of radiuses, and then this inner conductor and outer conductor, assuming that they are quite uniform along this length, can be considered to be extending along a particular line, which we conventionally have denoted to be the z-axis, right? So I ground the outer conductor, because outer conductor is easier to ground compared to the inner conductor, and if I want to apply a voltage, you know, I will apply a voltage by connecting the positive terminal of the voltage or the signal generator to the inner conductor. Okay, you can assume that the radius of the inner conductor, which we can denote by A, and the radius of the outer conductor, which we denote by B, are related in the sense that B is much, much larger than A. So in reality, if you look at a practical coaxial line, you are essentially looking like, you know, a very, very thin kind of a wire inside, and then surrounded by a fairly large diameter conductor. You can even fill the material inside a conductor with material of your choice. This filling of the material accomplishes two things. One, it gives a protection, mechanical protection to this system. You know, it gives us a mechanical strength so that you can use the cable connected to different points on your circuit. And two, it allows you to modify the speed with which this voltage and currents are traveling inside the coaxial line. But you don't really get to see all this, right? So the moment we say coaxial line and then we say, okay, this is what it is, you will immediately ask, based on whatever we have studied in the previous modules, right? You will ask, what is the R, L, C and G? And if someone calculates these values to you, then you replace this one. So this is the actual physical picture, right? This is how a coaxial cable would look like, more or less. I'm not looking at the micro surface roughnesses, but I'm just looking at a big picture kind of a thing, you know, macroscopic scale. This is how it would look like. So to you, it simply looks like a finite length transmission line with values of R, L, C and G given to you, right? The model that you have in your mind, so this is how you would represent. So this is how you would represent this coaxial line. So this is actually a coaxial cable. But to you, in the problems where you want to solve, find out the voltage at the output given the voltage at the input, you replace this coaxial line physical picture by these two straight lines which you think of as wires. Okay. Of course, we are assuming that everything is uniform along the z-axis. And the model that you would obtain, RLCG, from where you would obtain this one, would be something like this. So there is an inductance per unit cell, there is a series shunt conductance per unit cell, and a shunt capacitance per unit cell. So this is the kind of picture that you would have, right? So this picture, of course, continues all the way to infinity. This unit cell is a length delta z, which eventually goes off to zero. Therefore, these parameters R, L, G and C are per unit length parameters for you. So this is the model that you propose, whereas this is the physical picture and this is the representation on a piece of paper. How do you represent a coaxial cable? If I replace a coaxial cable with a microstrip conductor or a microstrip line, you would essentially represent even a microstrip line. Okay, so this is the ground plane for the microstrip and this is the signal layer here. Obviously, I have to connect any voltage source in this way so that the ground terminal is grounded and the positive potential or the positive terminal of the signal generator is connected to the signal layer of the microstrip line. So regardless of whether you are considering a coaxial cable or a microstrip line, your representation of that would be the same. So you would still represent that one with two pairs of lines which are supposed to represent the two conductor transmission line, one for ground, one for signal. And the picture of RLGC, these values will be different, but the picture of RLGC will remain the same. Now, of course, it's not the complete story, because if you recall from your earlier physics courses, suppose there is a charge, right, and there is another charge which, let us say, is oppositely directed, there is something called as an electric field between them. Why am I talking to you about this electric field and using this arrow and a length somewhere? Because if I look at the coaxial cable, this is the coaxial cable which is made out of conductor, and it is a property of a conductor that there are an excess number of electrons in the conductor, right? Surrounding this is a outer conductor which is also a conductor. So for our case, I am considering that these conductors are actually, you know, ideal round kind of a cases, but in practice they will not be, so they can be different. But no matter what it is, you have connected a certain voltage to the inner conductor and the outer conductor is grounded, which immediately causes a certain charge to be developed. This charge will not be present at the outside layer of the inner conductor, but it would be rather residing just below the inner conductor, and there will be negative charges spread all over. For a coaxial cable not to act or generate charges on its own, the amount of total charges that are present on the outer conductor will be equal to the charges that are present on the inner conductor. Okay, so this is what, for someone who is coming from a physics background, the corresponding cross section of a coaxial cable would look like. And immediately for that person, there will be electric field lines which would all emanate, okay, from a positive charge and terminates on a negative charge. Correct. So this is the picture that you would have. Also, for someone realizes that this coaxial cable is carrying a current I, the outer conductor is carrying a return current I, but for now let us not worry about the outer conductor, let us only worry about the inner conductor. So if there is a current I that is being carried, assume that this cross section of the inner conductor is so small that I can replace this one by a straight wire carrying a current I. Okay, this current I could be DC current or it could be AC current. Whether it is AC or DC current, you know that surrounding a current carrying wire there will be a magnetic field, right? How do you know that? Because if you remember about 200 or 300 years ago, or maybe 250 years ago, a person called Oersted made a very interesting discovery. He was presenting this in the class, and then he had a magnetic compass somewhere, and then he connected a current through a momentarily a small amount of current through the wires, and that caused a deflection in the magnetic compass. So the magnetic compass that was present, that was deflected. So this deflection is actually a very important thing, right? So this magnetic field was deflected, indicating, and we know that magnetic field exists because compasses react to magnetic fields. So if the north and south pole of a magnetic compass got deflected, then there must have been a magnetic field surrounding it, and this magnetic field could have only come from the current that is being carried by this wire, because there was no other magnetic sources which he had kept on the experimental table. So he made this discovery, which was later formulated into several laws according to Ampere and then modified later by Maxwell. But the critical point is that whenever there is a current carrying conductor, there will be a magnetic field. Of course, this magnetic field will be related to the inductor, because inductance is nothing but flux linkage associated with the current. These are all concepts that you are familiar with your physics background. And then if you were to look at the magnetic field lines, these field lines will be surrounding, and they would be, you know, going in a direction that is given by the right hand thumb rule. What is the right hand thumb rule? Suppose this is the way the current is carried, okay, along the direction of the pen. Then if you wrap your thumb around the pen, and then you are going around when your thumb is pointing in this direction, then this is the direction of the current being propagated, and this is the direction in which the magnetic fields exist. So if you look from the top, then you are essentially looking at the top, okay, in the form of a circle, and then there are these circular lines, right, which form the magnetic field. So you have magnetic field around a current carrying wire, you have electric field lines, as we would call, between the inner conductor and the outer conductor. So if you superimpose this, this is how the magnetic field lines would look. They should be circles, the direction being given by the direction of the current that would exist. Okay. So this is what a picture for someone who has studied physics would, physics and studied electrostatics and magnetostatics and a little bit of concepts such as inductance and capacitance would look like. So we have talked of inductance. Capacitance is also sitting in this structure, because I know that this electric field, if I integrate along any particular path, let's say this is the path along which I integrate, go from one point to another point, I know that the integral of this electric field over that particular path will give me the total voltage change along that path. We will develop all these relationships or derive these relationships or discuss these relationships later on. But for now, just understand that electric field gives you voltage, okay? And of course, electric field itself is caused by the charges, and voltage to charge ratio is the capacitor. Similarly, you have current which act as the source to generate the magnetic field, because integral of HDL will be the current that would be encompassed by that particular path. And this magnetic field will be related to the flux linkages. Via the flux linkages, you will get to the concept of, current, magnetic field, and then it would be related to the concept of inductance, right? So you at least are able to find out two circuit elements, capacitor and inductor, by going into this picture and provide these as inputs to the transmission line. Observe the way these electric field lines and the circles are arranged. The electric field lines are all going in this direction. So they are all going radially like this. Okay. So they are all going radially. And for each radius or for each direction, you have actually surrounded them with a circle. And the nature is that if I consider a circle here, okay, and then I have a line which is radially emanating from that one, at this point, the corresponding vector, we will talk about all this in just a few minutes. So there will be a corresponding vector here, and there will be a 90 degree between any radial line that you would consider and the circle. So in other words, the direction of the electric field and the magnetic fields are perpendicular to each other. Okay, at any point, if you look at this one, at any point around the path that you take, the direction of the electric field will be perpendicular to the direction of the magnetic field. Okay, so such configuration in which E is perpendicular to H is called as the transverse electromagnetic. So what we really have on a coaxial cable is not really a voltage and a current, but in the form of electric field and magnetic fields, and these fields are what is called as transverse electromagnetic, because electric field is perpendicular to the magnetic field. Okay, another way or another pattern that we can call as TEM or TEM would be this thing, right? So here you have electric and magnetic fields which are straight lines, not straight and a circle kind of a thing. This configuration is also TEM simply because electric field is perpendicular to the magnetic field at all points. This is essentially true. If I go back to the coaxial cable and then operate this coaxial cable at very, very high frequencies, essentially at very low wavelength. So at high frequencies or low wavelength, you would see that the electric field pattern doesn't remain, you know, radial, but actually develops a certain axial component to it. Axial meaning the direction of the voltage propagation, which was along the z axis that we had taken. The electric field lines will actually develop a certain one component along the path in which the voltage or the current is propagating. Okay, whereas the magnetic field still lies perpendicular to it. So you can imagine that the magnetic field lines are all coming out like this and then going in. Okay, so the magnetic field lines are all perpendicular to it, whereas the electric field line corresponds to a component along z axis. Okay, such a mode or such a pattern in which H is along the direction of the current, which is along the direction Z, whereas the electric field consists of two components, one along the Z axis and the other one which was the radial direction. We will talk about all these directions in a moment. So this kind of a configuration is called as TM mode, TM standing for transverse magnetic. If we so of course this is not the one that would actually get excited first when you connect a voltage generator. The lowest mode which gets excited when you connect a voltage source to the coaxial cable is still this radial and the circular combination, or the so-called transverse electromagnetic mode. Okay, the one pattern that would be excited as soon as you connect a voltage source with minimal effort is called as the lowest or the fundamental mode of that particular structure. And the fundamental mode of the structure for a coaxial cable is a TEM, and all the other modes are called as the higher order modes, and these are generated not at without any effort, but you have to put in a little bit of an effort. For example, you have to increase the frequency to very large values in order to observe this transverse magnetic mode in a coaxial cable. This mode also takes out a little bit of an energy and therefore corresponds to a little bit of loss of the total energy that you have supplied. In fact, the presence of higher order modes is not desirable for a coaxial cable, and it is the point which is what we would call as the bandwidth of the coaxial cable. Any frequency below this bandwidth will only excite the fundamental mode, but the moment you go beyond this one, you will start exciting the higher order modes, and once you excite the higher order modes, they will eat away part of your energy and contribute to loss. So this is the TEM and the TM mode picture that a person who has studied physics and person who has experimented would probably see this. Okay, so it is important to go back to the picture that we drew earlier, right? The first picture that we drew was this coaxial cable. This is the physical cable that you have. There is no picture here. It's actually a physical coaxial cable which consists of an inner conductor and an outer conductor. You ground the outer conductor, connect the signal source to the inner conductor. However, for a person who is looking at a coaxial cable or a microstrip line type of a structure, the corresponding way in which they look at will be to extract R, L, C and G values and then consider, no matter what kind of a transmission line you are considering, but to represent that one by two pairs of lines, okay, which are spaced a certain small distance apart. But the mental picture that they have in mind when they write these two wires is that of a R, L, G and C arranged in a series impedance and a shunt admittance configuration. Okay. So this is the picture no matter what type of physical transmission line that we have considered, whether it is microstrip or a coaxial. But for someone who has studied electromagnetics or who has studied electrostatics and magnetostatics, the picture will be different. For them, there are patterns of electric field, patterns of magnetic field, and these patterns of electric and magnetic fields cannot be arbitrary. Okay, they cannot be arbitrary, they have to follow Maxwell's equations, and these patterns are what we call as modes. Okay, it's just a geometric arrangement of the electric field and the magnetic field given the constraints of the problem. For example, you don't expect the direction of the electric field to be radial in a microstrip configuration simply because there are no circular conductors out there. The conductors there are plane, and therefore electric field lines will be slightly different. Okay. However, as long as these electric field lines and magnetic field lines are perpendicular to each other in this fashion, okay, then that particular arrangement of E and H fields is called as a transverse electromagnetic mode. In some modes of operation or in some region of operation, electric field or the magnetic field will develop a certain amount of axial component which corresponds to higher order modes, and they go into the name of transverse magnetic or transverse electric mode. In general, when the structure has no symmetry, when the structure is in a very general kind of a nature, you will have a combination, you will have a hybrid mode in which both magnetic field will have an axial component and the electric field will have an axial component, and the analysis of those structures and how to understand those is the subject that we are going to talk about now. Okay. Along this way of about 20 minutes of introduction, I have also spoken about certain things like vectors, and I called certain vectors are perpendicular to each other, certain vectors are not perpendicular to each other. What do I mean by all that is something that I would like to begin now. So we will first talk about a vector very, very briefly, a scalar very, very briefly. Talk about how to represent them by using coordinate systems, and then spend couple of modules talking about the vector calculus or the vector field calculus. Okay. So to refresh your memory, what is a scalar? Currency of a country is a scalar. Why do I call currency of a country to be a scalar? Because when I buy something, when I give money to this person, I am paying money. Okay, I am paying, let's say, 20 rupees or 30 rupees. I am not paying 20 rupees in the direction of north. I am not paying 20 rupees in the direction of southwest. There is no direction associated with this currency. Similarly, when doctors take, you know, our measurement of a temperature of the body, they say, okay, the temperature is about 100 degree Fahrenheit, right? They don't say 100 degree Fahrenheit along the direction 30 degrees from the horizontal axis. There is no direction or a sense of direction associated to these quantities, right? So in when you talk of these quantities which have no sense of direction, but they can only be specified by numbers, right? Those quantities are called as scalars. There are, of course, in addition to scalars, a large body of quantities which demand not only to specify the number, okay, but also to be specifying the direction. I say the speed of the car is 30 meter per second, then there is no problem with it. However, if I say the velocity of the car is 30 meter per hour or 30 meter per second, then you will immediately ask me, what is the direction of this car? Because I can have a car moving in the circle, or I can have a car moving along the direction, you know, in a straight line, or I can be moving from south to north or north to west, east to west. All kinds of possibilities are present, right? So one example of a vector quantity is velocity. Okay. Velocity has both sense of direction as well as the number that needs to be associated. Consider this kind of an arrangement, kind of a funnel or something, and let's say we fill it with water and water starts to flow. So initially water is all flowing along this path in a very nice manner, okay, but when it comes to the walls, it has to change direction because it has to go to the wall and of course cannot go in the same direction, so it changes its direction. So all these lines will similarly change direction and then they would propagate. You notice that the velocity of the lines here would be different, the velocity of the lines here are different, the velocity of the lines here are different. not only the numbers are different, but also the sense of direction in which the water or the fluid is flowing itself is different. So there is a sense of direction to the fluid or water movement inside a pipe, and that forms another example of a vector. Geometrically, we represent a vector by this straight line. So we represent a vector by a straight line. The length of this vector gives you the magnitude of the vector. Okay, so the magnitude of the vector gives you the length of the vector, or in this case they are essentially the same. And the orientation specified by the arrow, okay, arrow being the tail and this being the head of the vector, this will tell you in which direction this particular vector is arranged. Okay, for example, this would be the direction of a vector. It's a vector whose magnitude is small, whereas along the same direction this is a vector whose magnitude is large. Okay, this is a vector whose direction is opposite to the direction of the red one. Okay, and this is a vector which is a point vector or a zero vector. Okay, we say two vectors are perpendicular to each other because geometrically, when you look at them, those two vectors and arrange them in the fashion such that head of the first vector, tail of the first vector, head of the second vector goes into the head of the first vector, and the tail of the second vector is at this point. If the arrangement geometrically looks like this with the angle between the two vectors, then these two vectors are called as perpendicular vectors. We further denote a vector by a capital letter or a small letter, but then there will be an arrow on top of it in order to describe that this is a vector. You can also sometimes see us writing a hat on top of it. This hat signifies that there is a vector whose magnitude is equal to 1 unit, okay, and direction is in a particular given direction. Any vector can be thought of as being composed of this unit vectors, because you can actually describe a unit vector along the direction of the vector. So if the big vector was labeled as A, and I use another notation to denote a vector, I don't use an arrow, but I just put a bar over top of it. Okay, additional notations are to put an under bar. You know, there are a lot of notations, but I am going to use the notation which is slightly simpler. I just put a bar in order to denote a vector. Okay, and then I have this hat to denote a unit vector. The unit vector will be denoted, or the unit vector that I have denoted here is in the same direction as the big vector A. And you can very easily convince yourself that the big vector A can be written as some number times the unit vector, right? So it could be written as, say, 10 times the unit vector, because I can fit 10 such unit vectors along this. Okay, the number did not come out as 10, but just imagine whatever the number that comes out will be the numbers that I am going to put in. Okay, so this completes our extremely brief introduction to vectors. Okay, from the next module we will actually discuss coordinate systems, and then we go back to vectors or vector calculus. Okay, thank you very much.